I'm Matthias. I run Speedinvest X. X stands for Network Effects. It's the focus fund from Speedinvest, focusing on all things marketplaces, platforms, investing into early stage companies in Europe and in the US. I've been basically doing this for the last 10 years in different roles. I started my career in a VC fund, also started investing and focusing on marketplaces. One of my first investments was a company called Lieferando that then was acquired by Takeaway, a big food delivery marketplace. And after that, I also switched on the other side of the table and worked for a subsidiary of Naspers. Naspers is a big multinational media company that also invests in a lot of marketplace businesses and actually did M&A for them and buying and selling also parts of the business, also all focused on online marketplaces, online platforms, any kind of business with network effects. Before then joining actually Point Nine Capital out of Berlin to also build out their marketplace practice and focus on marketplaces within the team. And yeah, I did that until basically about a year ago when I had the opportunity to launch this new fund together with Speedinvest, which we did. And yeah, since then we've been building the team, building Speedinvest X. It's a little bit like a startup itself, and it feels like a startup. And also as part of that, hosting and organizing the marketplace conference. In the beginning, in my very first job, I kind of saw how powerful a marketplace can be and how also when network effects kick in and they unfold, how powerful that is from a business point of view. But then what I also liked about it from a more theoretical point of view is like how a marketplace creates transparency, creates trust, or can create trust, and basically makes everything more efficient. And I think those three pillars, the transparency, the efficiency, and the trust, is also something that I always continue to look at until today, and that is important to me also, beyond the whole financial side of things, so to say, and the powerful dynamics of a marketplace business model, but just as also, actually, to a certain degree also, creating a better society in certain ways. Coming back to those three pillars, trust, transparency, and efficiency, I think you have to think about how your product, your marketplace, is making the world a little bit better for all the participants on all those three dimensions, basically. For its users, for the participants on the marketplace. And I think if you're not really solving a problem for the participants, then you don't have a reason to exist, so to say, as a marketplace. But it's more like it's pretty soft, not that tangible, right? When I say it like this. So I think more on the kind of hard facts, or more focusing on that. What is important is to, I think, focus on engagement in the very, very first place. So that's what we look for also in the very early days, because we are pre-seed and seed investor. We obviously look at marketplaces that do not yet have network effects. So it's very hard to spot them, to identify them at the time when we look at it. So we have to see, okay, is there potential to develop network effects? If yes, then we look at, okay, what kind of problem is the marketplace solving around, for example, those three pillars that I mentioned. And then actually validating that by looking at how users are using it from the use case that this marketplace is built for and the kind of usage that I would be expecting based on that. Is the marketplace fulfilling that? So for example, if you do a marketplace for housing, you don't buy a house every month, right? And you probably, as an end consumer, and you probably only do it once every couple of years. So the frequency on such a marketplace is a different one, frequency of usage, than on a marketplace, or for example, the food delivery, where you order food every week, every other day. And so based on that kind of usage pattern that I would expect, I look at the engagement on the marketplace, and I say engagement because that's less financially, it's not like revenue or how much transaction volume and so on, it's more like How often do people log in? How do they use it? How many active weekly, monthly, daily users, and so on. And from that, we try to derive whether or not there's basically product market fit, or whether there's indication for product market fit, for early product market fit. And then based on that, if a company has a sort of MVP built and can show that there's some initial traction on those non-financial KPIs, that gets us excited. And this is where we say, okay, that I want to dig deeper, I want to learn more. I think there's something that gets us excited. Quite a few investments in the B2B space, actually. So I would say it's rather probably 50-50 between more consumer-focused and other more B2B-focused marketplaces. We've also done some first ventures into AR/VR space that I'm personally very excited about. Also, we recently invested into AdMix from London, for example, which is, you could argue, a bit of an ad tech business, but it is very, very much has marketplace dynamics because they connect buyers and sellers of advertising space, but in an AR/VR environment. So that is it's also something that is part of our thesis, because you have super strong network effects in this type of business. And another interesting one is a company called PackHealth, for example, from Poland, that does is actually in the B2B space, that does customized packaging for e-commerce shops or any kind of retailer. So on one end, you have lots of manufacturers of customized packaging, of printing facilities and so on. And on the other side, you have small and medium-sized e-commerce sellers that want to deliver their goods in their own customized branded packages. And they basically connect them, aggregate the volume, and by doing so allow to actually efficiently produce also smaller batches of customized parcels and still be able to take a margin out. And this is exactly what I mean. I say efficiency, for example, or trust and so on. And they actually make it possible. This is a market that today is not even there really, because big printing facilities and providers, they don't take on these small orders. It's not economically viable for them, but they make it possible to actually produce it in an economically viable and efficient way, and therefore they can generate business with that. And that's where technology also actually enables a marketplace, because they've built their own customization software, but also their own plotting software, basically on how it's plotted onto the for the printers, to put it simple. Yeah, I think there's a lot of opportunity still in B2B, because it's more blue ocean in comparison to B2C, for example. I think in B2C, a lot of categories have been covered already, but like kind of marketplace 1.0 approaches. But so if you want to build the next marketplace there, you have to really innovate on product, right? You have to really build a solution that is 10, 100 times better than what is there already, and try to break through the existing network effects. Whereas in B2B, there's just a lot of categories where there's no marketplace right now. There's nothing. Or at best, you maybe have a classifieds or a listing site, but there's no dominant player in a lot of verticals. So you can still come in kind of green field and just start from scratch and be a first mover. And so that's why also I think we like that space a lot, because there's an advantage in marketplaces to be the first one and be able to build up network effects actually over the time and kind of solve the chicken and egg problem without having to battle with someone else.